This video contains elements that are not suitable for children under the age of 14. Viewer discretion is advised. Hey guys, my name is Sean Faye Wolf, and welcome to Diamond Axe Studios Music, officially rated the 9th best music review channel on all of YouTube by some random top 10s page nobody's heard of or cares about. Now, I like to think that I've obtained this incredibly prestigious rank by providing witty, insightful commentary on the popular music of the past and present, coming up with interesting perspectives through which to look at these relics of pop culture that many overlook as background noise, but are nonetheless key in defining what our culture is and was. If you're new to this channel, and are looking to see the full extent of my analytical and commentative abilities, I suggest that you start by checking out my ranking of every number one hit of the 2010s, my countdown of the worst hit songs of 2019, or any of my recent videos that rank the top 20 songs in the country at the start of each season. All of those are videos that I'm incredibly proud of. They all provide a ton of really meaty songs for me to tear apart, and if you want to get an idea of what I consider to be my best work, those videos would be a great place to start. Probably the worst place to start would be this video right here, because... oh god, 2013. I've seen a good number of people discuss the pop music of 2013, and the general consensus seems to be that it was a bad year for the charts. Some say that they agree with that assessment, others try to fight back against it, but regardless, it's clear that the framework of the conversation is built around the year's bad reputation. And honestly, now that I've taken a crack at it myself, it's really easy to see why that is, because while I certainly don't think 2013 is the worst year of pop music in the 2010s, there is no year that I'm looking forward to analyzing less than 2013, and there's one simple reason for that. I don't just hate listening to the bad music of this year, I hate thinking about it. There is almost no fun to be had in mocking the worst music of 2013. With few exceptions, there's nothing wacky or outlandishly ridiculous on this list like you'll find in the bad music of other years. Most of the stuff here isn't horribly offensive or problematic, like Sad or Gummo or even Take Your Time. I mean, for fuck's sake, most of this music can't even manage to be obnoxious. It's just dull and deadening and featureless and lifeless and draining. Not only have my picks for the worst songs of the year been talked to death by this point, but there's just nothing to them. No one took any risks with these songs, they're all just worst versions of other songs that came out around the same time, and the only reaction they provoke is why the hell you would ever listen to them when the better version is right there 3 spots down the playlist. Most years, making fun of bad music is like scaling a wall in a rock climbing gym. You got all these weird-looking multicolored protrusions to grab onto, and the fun is trying to figure out which ones are the most worth grabbing onto to propel yourself upward. Analyzing the worst music of 2013 is like trying to climb a massive sand dune in the Sahara Desert. The entire thing looks the same, the sand keeps shifting under your feet and fighting against you as you climb, the sun is beating down on your back and making you miserable the entire time, and when you get to the top, there's no satisfaction or payoff. You're just getting scorched by the sun even more than when you started. But you know what? I guess that means I've been issued a challenge. Sitting around and making excuses doesn't accomplish anything, and so, as tempting as it is to just blow through these songs and give them as little attention and effort that they gave to me, I'm not gonna do that. My job is to analyze popular music in a way that's entertaining and engaging for you guys, and if the music doesn't feel like cooperating with me to that end, well, that's my problem, not yours. It turns out I've been playing music critic on easy mode for the past 3 years, and it seems the time has come to step it up a level. This is gonna be my greatest challenge yet, and I can't promise that this will be a smooth ride, but I'd be honored if you'd join me for it. Hope y'all are ready for this, because I'm about to take this sorry excuse for a year and give it the thrashing it deserves as we count down.
I'm waking up to TNT, I eat my pork and I craft my sword. I'm covered in these spider webs. Baby, you a song, and you make me wanna roll my.
So Florida Georgia Line are still the worst thing to ever happen to country music, right?
Yep.
Yeah, when I first saw that bikini top on her, she's popping right out of the South Georgia water.
Okay, right, so I went into this list with the same mentality I go into every one of my lists with, which is that no matter what, I'm going to be honest with both myself and you guys. The 10 songs that I've decided to put on this list are songs which, after months of re-listening, research, and analysis, I've found to be the most obnoxious, the most artistically bankrupt, and just overall the most worthy of scorn and derision out of all the music that was popular in 2013. And the fact that most of them happen to be really, really easy targets is a very frustrating coincidence. Look, I hate being predictable if I can help it. One of my favorite aspects of running this channel is being able to frequently find new discoveries, or pull out crazy hot takes that totally blindside everyone and make the experience of watching these videos even more exciting and interesting. And I'll just be upfront with you, that's not really something that's going to be happening in 2013, at least not with the worst list. As much as I love throwing curveballs at you guys, giving my opinions honestly is what's most important to me, and as it turns out, my thoughts on the worst music of this year happen to be pretty cut and dry along the lines of popular opinion, with no better way of demonstrating that than my first pick on the list being what's quite possibly the second most hated country song of all time, right behind that other one. We'll get to it. I'm sure you don't need me to break this song down for you. Anyone who's been within 10 feet of a radio in the past 7 years will have this song burned into the brain like a permanent, unscratchable itch, and a discussion of this song's individual parts will show nothing more or less than the barest, most obvious, most textbook examples of each and every cliché of bro country, which, incidentally, is perhaps the most cliché-happy genre of the past 50 years. It's all here. Watered-down production that barely even pays lip service to the traditions of country? Check. Two meat-headed douchebags with the same general disposition as the leads of any contemporary Nickelodeon cartoon? In this brand new Chevy with a lift kit, would look a hell of a lot better with you up in it. Check. Viewing women is nothing more than pairs of legs that bring you beer occasionally? She's popping right out of the South Georgia water doll. Oh, good lord, she had them long-tailed legs. That would be a check. Honestly though, even listing all this feels so pointless and tired because everyone knows that bro country is a lame genre that sucks ass, and this is the first song everyone uses to illustrate that. It's like trying to convince people that Logan Paul is awful by bringing up the Suicide Forest video. We all know that he's awful and we all know why, and unlike Logan Paul, bro country really isn't a problem we have to deal with that often anymore, so I don't see any point in dragging this out. It's just not worth it. Really, the only thing I have to say about Cruz Remix is that I feel like Nelly's verse doesn't really get the flack it deserves. I mean, I guess the actual rapping is fine enough, but the guy's got the singing voice of a squashed tomato. I can see you got a thing for the fast life, so come on shorty, let me show you what the fast life. Oh, and also people tend to forget that this part exists. Cause baby, you a song and you make me wanna roll my, roll my, roll my. Well, that was awkward, undignified, and stupid, but I think you knew that already. Get your radio. They're breaking in, surprise attack, so I jump on my horse's back. This is it, the apocalypse. Knew you were gonna come to me. Oh, Katy Perry, what do we do with you? The transition in style and substance between Katy Perry's third and fourth studio albums, Teenage Dream and Prism, is very interesting to me, because even though both of these albums sold like gangbusters and produced world-conquering singles, one of them seems to be much more well-remembered and held in higher regard than the other. I don't think the singles off of Prism are bad, per se, but after Teenage Dream and its singles basically defined what the first couple years of the 2010s sounded like, they just weren't able to keep up the momentum of Katy's career, and I'm not surprised that she's been struggling ever since then. Whereas Teenage Dream truly captured the spirit of adolescent fun and was able to manifest the joy and freedom of the best parts of young adulthood into audio, Prism just felt like a weak attempt to recapture that fun after the life had already faded from behind its eyes. With no better way of showing this than by comparing the empowerment anthems. Off of Teenage Dream, we had Firework, a song that truly lived up to its name and was able to overcome some clumsy songwriting choices with a swell of orchestral grandeur that actually succeeds in being uplifting on a purely sonic level, a song where it's truly impossible to be in a bad mood after hearing it. And off of Prism, we got this. I got the eye of the tiger. Yes, Roar by Katy Perry, one of the least ambitious, most milquetoast, paint-by-the-numbers chart-toppers in recent memory that tries to be uplifting by claiming that she's stepping up and taking control over her direction in life, despite obviously having absolutely no control over the direction of this song. I know people tend to forget this, but the term self-empowerment anthem still has the word power slotted snugly into the middle of it. And yet this is the most weak-sauce shit I've heard in a long, long time. A couple years ago, I looked forward at the hit songs of 2013, and I was sure that Roar would be number one on this list when I got around to making it. It actually didn't end up on the list at all. The only reason I'm even talking about it is because as far as analyzing empowerment anthems go, comparing Katy Perry songs seemed a bit more interesting than turning into yet another internet jerk-off shitting all over Pitbull. I mean, I don't know if this can technically be classed as an empowerment anthem. Probably not. It's more of a plea to live in the moment and enjoy life to the fullest, wrapped up in an EDM-flavored club banger. And this song clearly did strike a chord with a lot of people. I mean, after all, it was the theme song for the emoji pop dance craze that was all the rage back in 2017. So, I don't know, maybe I'm just kinda weird for thinking that Christina Aguilera blurting out the same four lines over and over again over a synth riff lifted directly from Take On Me for no reason other than cheap nostalgia bait isn't too inspiring. I will grant that this song is at least more energetic than something like Roar, but there's a difference between hyping someone up to tackle whatever the world throws at them and just yelling, "Enjoy life! Enjoy life! Enjoy life!" over and over again at the top of your lungs. It's a real statement to just how vapid this song is that the only lyric anybody remembers from it is the title line, because the rest of Christina's hook is empty nonsense, and then there's Pitbull. And I make dollars, I mean billions. I'm a genius, I mean brilliance. The conversation around Pitbull and his music has been very interesting to watch over the past few years, because despite him being one of the least beloved and most easily mocked musicians alive during his peak, there seem to be quite a lot of people nowadays saying that they miss Pitbull and finding themselves nostalgic over his music. Now, obviously people are entitled to their preferences, and I'm sure that there are some people to who this generalization doesn't apply, but I'm gonna say it anyways. People aren't nostalgic for Pitbull. People are nostalgic for everything Pitbull represents. Pitbull's first real hit was in 2009, and his last real hit was in 2015, and whether this is a coincidence or not, these years mark a stretch of time from the moment pop music turned into a giant party right up until the exact moment that that party came crashing down and the crushing gloom of reality developed the world, pop music included. The years of Pitbull's career are synonymous with the renewed sense of optimism and hope people had during the Obama administration, and much like that sense of optimism and hope, Pitbull's music during this time was stupid, divorced from reality, extremely irritating in anything more than small doses, but nonetheless extremely infectious. Time of Our Lives, the last hit that Pitbull had, was about plugging your ears and partying onward despite the imminent threat of a landlord coming to evict you the next day. And I think that just about sums it up. The next few years of music after 2015 were all about paying the Pied Piper, whereas Pitbull was about enjoying the Piper's music without a care in the world. However, I think it's still safe to say that the idea of Pitbull is entirely more appealing than the actual man and his music, and Feel This Moment, beyond being a terrible version of what it's trying to be, is also probably the least Pitbull hit that Pitbull has ever had. His rapping is nothing but the same empty luxury porn it boasts about his fame and brilliance that he's always done, and beyond feeling even more hollow than ever now that his career has flamed out, the song outside of the stolen synth hook is just so crushingly dour and low-key that Pitbull's lyrics come across less like inspirational hype and more like what they really are, which is a multi-millionaire bragging about how much better he has it than you. It's a shitty song even by Pitbull standards, and you know what? I'm thrilled that this song's main cultural association is now Christina Aguilera shilling a song that isn't even hers in an advertisement for a soulless knockoff of DDR artlessly baked into the middle of one of the worst films of all time. I mean, if the shoe fits. Bet your ass on that, Petty. This girl is on fire. This girl is on fire. Alicia Keys is one of with this artist who's a lot less interesting than she is good. And that leads to a very difficult tightrope to balance on when it comes to maintaining a consistent career. I don't think that it's controversial to say that she peaked early, with her best song immediately shooting to number one and breaking her through. While she continued to see success straight through to the end of the decade, I hesitate to say that she really left that big of an impact, all things considered, owing in large part to the fact that she never really established much of an identity outside of ridiculously talented R&B pianist who's pretty good at singing. Simply put, Alicia Keys was an artist who people were inspired by more than they were interested in. And so I guess her turn towards boring American Idol-style empowerment schlock really wasn't that hard to see coming. Out of all the songs in that genre, I guess Girl on Fire isn't the worst of them. After all, Alicia still has a great voice, even if she is sounding a bit shouty here for my taste, and this song does stand out from other empowerment anthems by leaning more towards the nice, comfortable mid-level power of R&B rather than the paper-thin pianos or overproduced hyperpop the genre typically vomits up. But honestly, if I'm praising a song for literally being middle of the road, that should tell you the kind of song we're talking about, and unfortunately, the lyrics follow this trend to an infuriating degree.
We got our feet on the ground.
I called out Cruise for being cliché-ridden a few minutes ago, but at the very least, those clichés of Fanboy and Chum Chum there acting like a pair of drunken ballsacks managed to convey that at least they were having fun. Girl on Fire doesn't convey anything like that, because Girl on Fire doesn't have anything to convey. The entire point of this song is to provide a cheap, fleeting little ego boost to every single human being with a pair of X chromosomes who hears it. Its sole purpose is to make women feel empowered, and it does that about as well as a Yas Queen temporary tattoo. The words girl and fire are quite possibly the two most commonly used words in the entirety of pop music, and this song's primary function is to just shout them over and over again, occasionally with some synonyms, but usually just outright, with nothing but other slightly less used cliches sprinkled in between them. When I said the bad music of 2013 was miserable to talk about, this is what I mean. Girl on Fire isn't dumb, it isn't wacky, it isn't offensive, and it isn't laughable. It's just a boring waste of time that says nothing, means nothing, and yet received rapturous critical acclaim from critics all over the world as a deeply inspiring and moving anthem to power and womanhood, despite the fact that the very next single off the album, Brand New Me, actually is a deeply personal dive into Alicia's evolution of learning how to stand up for herself and regain her self-respect after being dragged down to dark places, which got completely ignored by the public while this phoned-in piece of crap hit the top 10. It's the definition of radio filler that represents the final step in the Kelly Clarksonization of Alicia Keys. And there's not one single interesting thing about it except this waste of human plasma.
Spirit of Marilyn calling me, audibly, bawling she, said that she would never leave, continue to torture me.
Yeah, for any of you who thought that Nicki Minaj belly flopping her way onto other people's songs just for a cheap promotional push was a new thing that started in 2020, no, she's been doing it for a while now, and apparently her version of Girl on Fire, known as the Inferno remix, was the version that made the year-end list. I don't know how that's possible, considering that I have literally never once heard this version anywhere outside of YouTube, and also because these verses are total ass. Much like on Say So, Nicki raps about nothing but herself, weaving in some confused metaphor about how the spirit of Marilyn Monroe is torturing her and telling her to kill herself. Your guess is as good as mine. And then later, a second verse that I swear she lifted directly out of Mad Lib's Fun on the Farm.
Do you fear God? Cause I fear God. And in my backyard, that's a deer God. And that's a horse ranch.
Oh, and there's also this.
And to my core fans, keep repping me. Do it to the death of me.
Fuck you!
But I got him Aggie, cause I win the gold like Gabby.
She's just a girl and she's on fire.
This is quite possibly the single most disconnected rap verse I've ever heard on a pop song, with absolutely nothing to do with Alicia's parts lyrically or musically. It sounds like something that was thrown together in literally 10 minutes that was added to the song at the last minute. And frankly, I suspect that the entire reason Nicki's verse was added was just so that Alicia could pull this stunt at the 2012 VMAs.
But I got him aggy, cause I win the gold like Gabby.
This girl is on fire.
And I think that about sums it up. Nothing better represents what this song is about than Olympic gold medalist Gabby Douglas, one of the most talented athletes alive, doing 5 cartwheels and then immediately walking away while the entire theater explodes into applause. Alicia Keys is a perfect example of what can go wrong when you try to build a career on raw vocal talent and nothing else. And Nicki Minaj is a perfect example of everything wrong with everything. If you wanted Girl on Fire to thrive, then maybe you shouldn't have watered it down so much. Next. Whoa, whoa, whoa. Okay, look, I know I went on the whole spiel in the beginning about how I wasn't gonna be lazy and I was gonna give every song its full due, but this next song was only barely a hit, and the two men who made it are only barely artists, so fuck it, this'll be quick. Power. I got that power. When it comes to songs that have no unique qualities to latch onto or analyze and are just a shitty version of everything else popular around it, this song is an example so definitive that it makes everything we've talked about so far look like a crossover between Gorillaz and 100 Gecs. In fact, I was seriously tempted to just give up any pretense of criticism and just play this footage of me throwing tomatoes at the single cover. This is the worst kind of music by Algorithm, assembled with no passion, care, or artistry, which is obviously par for the course for Justin Bieber, even back in 2013, but at the very least I expected will.i.am to come up with some sort of interesting audio gimmick to base the song around. Even if it were awful, which it very likely would have been, at least it would have been memorable. How the hell do you go from songs like I'm a Bee, which has so many disparate musical ideas stuck onto it that listening to it is like trying to play soccer with a Katamari, to this, which has nothing but one single bass thud and a couple atonal synth hits that pop in later. I mean, I'll admit that it is impressive that will.i.am was able to make something so minimalist and bare-bones still sound as obnoxious as shit, but this song's prevailing quality is laziness, and it's not at all surprising to me that this was the song that finally managed to take Willie's hit-making career for long enough that he was only able to come back as a fixture of the nostalgia circuit. Oh, and there is one other thing about this song that's noteworthy, and that's the lyrics. Oh, not because they're any good, because they're not. They make Vanilla Ice sound like Kendrick Lamar. They call me Willie, stay so cool, I'm chilly. I done made that melee, on my way to that belly. Used to have a piggy bank, but now I got that bigger bank. Poetry. But no, the specific lyrics themselves aren't what I have a problem with. It's the attitude of it all. Bragging is obviously old hat in hip-hop. It's practically synonymous with the genre, and I know that complaining about the lyrics and attitude of a will.i.am song is quite possibly the lamest thing anyone's done since Ben Shapiro reclaimed his virginity. But I'm genuinely bothered that will.i.am chose to use this absolute headache of a beat to brag about how he's the best producer in the world, and people only hate on him because they're jealous. Who cares what the haters say? They hate on me cause I'm doing what they can't. I mean, bragging like that has been will.i.am's default setting since Boom Boom Pow, but it didn't bother me then because at the very least I believe that he thought he was a genius who was bringing the world into a new age of music. I don't think that even he's stupid enough to truly believe that this half-assed piece of nothing is anything more than a phoned-in half-effort, and yet he continues to gloat and brag like he's the next Timbaland or something. No, he's not, and I am done dealing with him. I raise my soul, don my armor. It's an uprising, I suppose. We're painted gray to fit right in. You know, I was originally gonna put this song at the bottom of this list so that I could make the obvious joke about it, but I ultimately decided not to because honestly, fuck Drake. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team fucking here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Drake is to the 2010s what carbon is to the Earth's atmosphere. Absolutely everywhere. Actually, pretty good to have around in healthy amounts, but too much of it tends to overpower and smother everything while irreparably fucking up the entire ecosystem. And in this metaphor, we're currently at the same point with Drake that we are in real life. Well past the point of no return and still barreling headfirst into disaster with no signs that we're gonna change our ways for the better anytime soon. It's genuinely odd to go back and look at older Drake songs, back to a time where he wasn't seen as this unstoppable musical megaforce who's made the Hot 100 his bitch while spreading his influence over music like a dull gray haze. This was back in the day where Nicki Minaj and Drake were still seen as two halves of the same coin, as firebrand Young Money up-and-comers with enormous potential. Unlike today, where the only real connection the two have is representing the two most common ways the Hot 100 gets manipulated. Yep, Drake truly has reached the top of the world these days, and if you're curious as to how he got there, the absolute last place I would recommend checking out is this song. With a title like Started From The Bottom, you'd expect this song to be Drake's reflection on all the ways he's busted his ass to get to the lofty position in pop culture that he was able to attain, which, while not as high as it is today, was still absolutely stellar in 2013. And I will admit that when I first listened to this song, I thought that its main problem was that it just doesn't do that. Everyone I've ever heard talk about this song says that its main issue is that Drake spends no time talking about his actual struggle, instead choosing to spend all the time flexing how far he's been able to make it. After all, the hook does go, started at the bottom, now we hear, which even by itself gives the impression that Drake viewed his journey upwards as an afterthought that he doesn't care to discuss. This isn't true. Drake does care. Drake cares a lot.
We just want the credit where it's due.
In actuality, the point of this song isn't Drake talking about his rise out of poverty and being grateful or trying to inspire people or even trying to brag about it. Instead, this is the first of many in a long, long line of Drake hits that are attempting to defend himself against the nebulous mob of haters that are apparently lurking all around him. You know the ones I'm talking about. The ones who are apparently trying to end him and wishing bad things on him.
Sorry if I'm way less friendly. I got niggas trying to end me.
It's a lot of bad things that they wish and 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 on me.
Yes, one of the most insufferable of Drake's little quirks, his constant bellyaching about how there are people out there who are mean to him, began here in Started From The Bottom. This isn't the first time Drake touched the subject, but it is the first big hit of his that made it the central focus.
Boys tell stories about the man. Say I never struggled, wasn't hungry, yeah, I doubt it, nigga. Fuck a fake friend, where your real friends at? Stories stay the same through the money and the fame.
Now, let's set aside the fact that I have no idea why anyone besides Drake himself would possibly care about that, and let's also set aside that this lack of interest is further compounded by an uninspired, uber-repetitive beat with really obnoxious grinding percussion and some of the most Xanax delivery Drake's given in the entire past decade of him basically being the mascot for Xanax. Let's say for whatever reason you're drawn into this dilemma of Drake's, and you want to hear him defend his street cred by talking up all the awful shit he's had to go through. You know, hear his version of what Roddy Ricch did on Ballin'.
Cause I'm getting money now, I know you heard that. Young nigga on the corner, bitch, I had to serve crack. Uncle fronted me some peas, had to get in birds back. We came up on dirty money, I gave it a bird back.
So, yeah, I can't say I'm not interested to hear what Drake had to overcome on his climb out of poverty. So, go ahead, Drake. Paint me a picture.
I done kept it real from the jump. Living at my mama's house, we'd argue every month, nigga. I was trying to get it on my own. Working all night, traffic on the way home. And my uncle calling me like, where you at? I gave you the keys, told you bring it right back, nigga.
Alright. So, the struggles you had to go through to get where you are as a rapper include arguing with your mom while she let you live at her house, hitting traffic on your way home from work, and... sorry, what was that last one?
My uncle calling me like, where you at? I gave you the keys, so you bring it right back.
Oh, I see. Your uncle yelled at you for going on joyrides in the drop-top sports car he let you borrow. Well, I've got to say, Drake, I would put up a lighter to show my solidarity with you through these absolutely monumental obstacles you had to overcome. But, yeah, wouldn't you know it, my lighter kind of ran out of fluid earlier today, so, yeah, it's kind of annoying. I guess I'll have to run down to the mobile station to get another one later. I'm sure that that's another major life struggle that you can really relate to.
We just want the credit where it's due. I'ma worry about me, give a fuck about you, nigga.
Look, I know Drake didn't have the easiest life growing up. His parents split when he was 5, his dad went to jail on drug charges, and he grew up in a rough area with even rougher schools, and I'm sure that wasn't easy. It's definitely more of a struggle than I've had to go through. However, even if Drake did have obstacles to overcome to make it to where he is now, that doesn't mean he knows how to communicate those struggles through music. And more to the point, if these are the kind of issues that Drake points to as his struggle, then it's really really clear to me that he doesn't genuinely hold that struggle as part of his identity. His response was to take irritations and annoyances from his time growing up and wear them like a Halloween mask to claim that he went through the struggle. And he ends up painting a picture of himself about as sympathetic as Bill Gates guessing that a pack of pizza rolls costs $22. Again, I'm not saying that Drake didn't have to overcome real hardships growing up. I don't know the details of his early life. But if he was bothered enough about these accusations to put pen to paper and write a response to it, and this was the response he came up with, well, let's just say that makes it a bit more understandable why he's apparently got hordes of nebulous mystery men wishing bad things on him. Oh, and also the song sounds like ass. Just want to reiterate that. And that'll do for part one of this video. Part two will be coming out soon, and unlike part one, part two will actually have songs in there that go beyond being just a boring waste of time and actively piss me off. So, yeah, stay tuned for that. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, I'd really appreciate it if you would leave me a like, subscribe to the channel and set a notification for every new upload, and leave a comment telling me your thoughts on the video, on the music of 2013, or anything else you want to say. These likes and comments also increase the chances that YouTube will recommend this video to new people, and even beyond that, I'd just love to see them, so I'd really appreciate it if you could do that for me. If you would like to support me even more, I would be honored if you would consider joining my Patreon. For just $2 per main series video, you'll get to vote for any song in the world you'd like to see me talk about in my Grab Bag Reviews series, the next episode of which will be coming out towards the end of September. For $5 per video, not only will you get access to the exclusive Diamond X Studios Discord server, where we hang out, talk about music, videos, memes, and play Jackbox on a fairly regular basis, but you'll also get your names in the credits alongside these absolutely lovely ladies and gentlemen. For $10 per video, not only will you get access to the Discord server and your name in the credits, but you'll get a shout out in every video I make, alongside Bald Mark, Celeste Sucks, Cowie Quawoma, Flarbu, Fox Navarro, Fruit Goblin, It's Just Louise, Jeffrey Berman, Kumarai Fang, Liam Kinch, Luke Newman, Mike Duggar, Nick Cage, Pierre Lou Lang, Prideful Zella, Pullen Pong, Ryan Easter, Sean Fay Wolf is secretly a member of the Barbs, Tim Shoup, and Yoshi EX26. And last but not least, for $20 per video, you'll get to see every main upload a day or two early, even before the official premiere, and you'll get to be one of my top supporters alongside Adrian Julian, Eric Strebing, KFW, MikeRamp72, Moment Reviews, Silmeril, and Ultranatic Productions. Like I've said before, I can't monetize my videos because of the copyrighted clips I use, so support from you guys is my only source of income from this channel, and considering that my goal is to make YouTube videos full-time, I truly can't thank you enough for your support, and I hope that even more of you will consider joining in the future. I'm Sean Fay Wolf of Diamond X Studios, thank you so much for watching, and if you'll excuse me, I'm going to go eat a cookie to reward myself for getting through the entire Girl on Fire segment without making a Hunger Games joke. See you next time.